Number 10. German hideout in South America. Nestled in the thick vegetation of Argentina's Deyoquara National Park is a mysterious site that has long been associated with legends of a secretive German settlement. For decades following World War II, rumors circulated about the alleged Nazi hideout. It wasn't until 2015 that archaeologists finally announced with some level of certainty that there might actually be some truth behind these stories. There's not much to see at first glance when looking near the border of Paraguay in the northeastern province of Misiones. The team painstakingly excavated the overgrown site and found just enough evidence to believe that German immigrants may have lived there. Their discoveries included fragments of a German-made plate and five German coins that were minted between 1938 and 1941, which falls in line nicely with the timeline of a post-World War II settlement. There are also several structures, including what's left of a house that had enough room for 6 to 8 families. It's surrounded by 10-foot-thick walls, and there's a nearby hilltop watchtower. The location is extremely remote. It would have been difficult to reach back in the 1940s, and even harder to survive in. Between the end of the war and 1955, at least 5,000 German immigrants moved to Argentina. Most of them lived in cities or on ranches, rather than bunkers, suggesting that the clandestine refuge was built before Germans began migrating to Argentina in large numbers. Or perhaps the secretive settlement housed former military members who were trying to avoid facing their war crimes. There are some skeptics who have suggested that perhaps the site was a failed homestead, or maybe that it was built by a group of people who didn't necessarily come from Germany. Some believe that the popular legends surrounding the settlement may have been perpetuated as a way to boost tourism profits. Number 9. Atomic bomb loading pits. American forces dropped the world's first atomic bomb over the Japanese city of Hiroshima from a B-29 bomber on August 6, 1945. Just days later, they dropped another atomic bomb over Nagasaki. The aircraft left for its mission from an airfield on Tinian Island, which is part of the Mariana Islands. It made sense for the military to launch the operation from Tinian, which sits just over 1,500 miles from Japan. After capturing the island from the Japanese, soldiers spent 45 days working day and night building runways, docks, barracks, an administration building, oil storage facilities, a weapons depot, 2 bomb loading pits, in an air-conditioned bomb assembly building on the northern end of the island. Known as Northfield, it was the world's biggest airport at the time. It was impossible to load the massive bombs onto the airplane the old-fashioned way. Instead, they were hoisted into the plane's underside and secured to a hydraulic mount. Pit number 1 was used to load the 4-ton uranium bomb that fell over Hiroshima, known as Little Boy. A plutonium bomb nicknamed Fat Man was loaded onto the aircraft using pit number 2. After the second bombing, the Japanese emperor surrendered unconditionally to the Allies, officially bringing World War II to an end. Today, the takeoff site has been almost completely retaken by wildlife. Very little remains there, besides 2 loading pits that were used for getting the nuclear weapons onto the plane. On the 60th anniversary of the battles of Saipan and Tinian in 2004, 2 commemorative plaques were placed at the site. Those who look closely enough can also see the remnants of some of the old buildings and runways, which are becoming less and less noticeable as the man-made structures continue to be overtaken by foliage. Number 8. Battle of Guadalcanal. Guadalcanal is one of the southern Solomon Islands in the South Pacific. During World War II, the Battle of Guadalcanal consisted of a series of land and sea clashes between Allied and Japanese forces. marking a turning point in favor of the Allies in the Pacific War. On July 6, 1942, the Japanese moved troops and laborers to Guadalcanal and began constructing an airfield. The Allies recognized that operating from this field would threaten other military bases in nearby ports, and immediate steps were taken to rid the Japanese of the areas, utilizing forces that were available in the South Pacific. Some 6,000 men of the U.S. 1st Marine Division launched an amphibious assault on Guadalcanal, surprising the 2,000 Japanese defenders. The landings were made with strong naval and air support and met with little resistance. The airfield was seized within 36 hours. Losses were heavy on both sides, but the battle was necessary to make sure the Solomon Islands were never seriously threatened again. Thousands lost their lives, while several more thousand died from malaria and other tropical diseases. The various naval battles cost each side warships, cruisers, destroyers, submarines, and tanks, some of which are still visible today in the jungles of Guadalcanal. Number 7. Plane Wreck in Paradise. During the Long Battle of Peleliu in 1944, U.S. soldiers shot down a Japanese Aichi E-13A fighter plane in the Republic of Palau. It sank to the bottom of the sea in the waters off the state of Korar and remains remarkably intact to this day. Of course, time and Mother Nature have taken their toll on the submerged aircraft, but it's in good shape for its age, making it a popular diving site. Images of the wreck circulated on social media in recent years, sparking discussion about how it's hard to imagine what such a serene, peaceful place looked like as a war zone. Used by the Japanese military from 1941 to 1945, the Aichi E-13A was a reconnaissance aircraft that was capable of carrying 550 pounds of bombs. It was designed for 3 crew members. Over 1,400 of them were made during the war, but there are no known surviving airworthy examples. The sunken plane is just one of around 60 abandoned World War II-era vehicles throughout Palau, leading some to call it the wreck capital of the world. Have you ever been up close to a warplane? Let us know in the comments and be sure to subscribe while you're at it. Number 6. Johnston Island Air Force Base. In 1935, the US Navy got to work turning a coral atoll in the South Pacific, known as Johnston Island, into a military base and airport. Located several hundred miles southwest of Hawaii, the site consisted of an airfield, an aircraft parking area, and a causeway connecting the base to nearby Sand Island, where the barracks were located. At its peak, the base was home to around 1,200 military members and contractors. In addition to its military use, the airport serviced a small number of commercial flights under Aloha Airlines and Continental Micronesia, neither of which are still in business. Whether an aircraft landed, it was surrounded by military personnel. Passengers were not allowed to leave the plane unsupervised. During the 1960s, the government used the site for performing nuclear tests on barges full of monkeys. By then, the base no longer serviced civilian flights. The explosive experiments left the area highly contaminated with plutonium. The tiny airport remained in operation until the base officially closed in 2005. For a while after that, it functioned as a diversion airport for emergency landings. Because the runway is no longer maintained, it's no longer considered appropriate to use. But it's a better alternative to landing in the water in the event of an extreme flight emergency. All that's left of the facility is the single 9,000-foot runway and taxiway, along with a paved ramp. Nobody lives on the island, and the only visitors it receives are government employees and military members. The Air Force still owns and controls the site, where pollution from the nuclear tests is an ongoing concern. Number 5. Pacific Radar Barrier 3. Saipan is the largest of the Northern Mariana Islands and a U.S. Commonwealth. The island is located in the Western Pacific, roughly 5,900 miles from the American mainland. This remote tropical paradise is where the U.S. and Japan came face to face in 1944 in a gruesome weeks-long battle that lasted for nearly a month. During the Cold War, the U.S. Air Force installed a radar tower on the highest point in Saipan, known as Mount Petasakura. They removed a patch of dense foliage and put the 40-foot structure in its place. Saipan became the American military's third Pacific Barrier radar site, or PACBAR 3 for short. Built with parts that were salvaged from a decommissioned Navy ship, these towers were implemented with the intention of detecting and tracking Soviet satellites and missile launches. The other two radar sites, known as PACBAR 1 and PACBAR 2, were in the Marshall Islands and in the Philippines. PACBAR 3 wasn't in service for long before it was no longer needed. The military cleared out when the Cold War ended during the early 1990s, and it hasn't been used since. Since then, the tower and its surrounding buildings have fallen into disrepair. Nature has started to reclaim the site, which is slowly being swallowed by the encroaching jungle. All that's left of the former outpost is the tower itself and a few rusting, graffiti-covered buildings. Number 4. Corregidor Island. After arriving in the Philippines in the 16th century, Spanish colonizers built a defense fortress, a jail, and inspection station on a small landmass in Manila Bay called Corregidor Island. Many battles have occurred there throughout history, including the Spanish-American War and during the American colonial period. The island's oldest structure is a lighthouse dating back to 1853. But most of Corregidor's decaying buildings reflect the brutal fighting that went on there during World War II. Included among the ruins are several defense and battery buildings, shops, a movie theater, a swimming pool, and a golf course, which were built and used by American soldiers who were stationed at Corregidor. When the Japanese invaded Manila during the Battle of the Philippines in 1941, American and Filipino troops fought with all their strength to try driving the intruders out, but they lost the battle and surrendered Corregidor to the Japanese in 1942. After months of fighting, American and Philippine forces recaptured the island in 1945. Today, it remains very much how it was left at the end of the war. It almost seems like the fighting has just stopped and nobody has gotten around to cleaning up the mess that was left behind. Tour guides are still discovering things on the island dating as far back as the early 20th century, when American and Filipino soldiers were first stationed on the island together. In addition to the ground-level structures at Corregidor, there's a series of dark underground tunnels. Legend has it that the corridors are haunted by the ghosts of Japanese soldiers who took their own lives in the face of defeat. But even if there are no spirits inside the tunnels, they're eerie nevertheless, especially considering all the violence that went on at Corregidor. Today, the site is a war memorial and a designated national monument. The ruins are maintained out of respect and in the memory of the American, Philippine, and Japanese soldiers who lost their lives on Corregidor. Number 3. The Tunnels of Rabaul. In 1942, Japanese forces occupied the town of Rabaul in Papua New Guinea. The region is known for being one of the world's most active earthquake regions, but this didn't stop the Japanese from building a military complex there. More than 97,000 soldiers and other personnel lived there at its peak. Due to its remoteness, Rabaul was extremely vulnerable to air attacks, which happened frequently. To avoid death as much as possible, workers dug 300 miles of underground tunnels and numerous fully functioning facilities, including a hospital, barracks, storehouses, command centers, and more. The structure was truly impressive, with some of its chambers measuring 4 stories tall. By the time it was finished, it was one of the world's longest and most elaborate tunnel systems. Some of the pathways were cut right out of the rock, while others were supported by palm beams. In addition to the tunnels, the workers carved out entire concrete bunkers. Allied forces drove the Japanese out of Rabaul toward the end of the war. The base and tunnels were abandoned, and most of their contents were eventually cleared out. In 1994, a volcanic eruption buried most of the city in ash. The area's recovery has been slow going, but seems promising. As things continue to improve, locals are rediscovering the tunnels along with numerous decaying relics that were left behind after the conflict, including wrecked fighter jets. Military graffiti still covers the command center's walls. Sadly, the individuals who built the subterranean system were forced laborers who had been captured in Malaysia, China, and Singapore. Many died from starvation, disease, being overworked, and other forms of cruel treatment that they endured. Prisoners of war were also forced to endure the hellish conditions at Rabaul. They were crammed into a filthy and unbearably hot cave, where they received no food or water. In a desperate attempt to stay alive, the soldiers sucked moisture out of a blackout curtain. After an especially brutal Allied air raid one day, Japanese guards marched 21 prisoners outside and executed them in what became known as the Tunnel Hill Massacre. Number 2. Tillamook Bay. In 1942, the U.S. Navy built a sprawling 1,600-acre base at Tillamook Bay, Oregon. The sprawling property originally contained more than 60 buildings. For the next 3 years, blimp squadrons operated out of Tillamook Bay, patrolling the Pacific and searching for signs of nearby enemies. But the military presence there was short-lived. The base was all but forgotten about after the war, and it was officially decommissioned in 1948. Since then, the site has been slowly rusting away in the Oregon forest. Many people don't even know that the ruins exist because they're so well hidden. 35 of the original buildings still stand, including an airplane hangar, but they're rapidly falling into disrepair from years of neglect as nature takes back over. The property is also scattered with numerous objects that were left behind, including trains, a boat, planes, and other decaying vehicles. Number 1. Talisia Airfield. Both the Americans and the Japanese occupied the village of Talisia in Papua New Guinea at various points throughout World War II. It was home to an airstrip built by the Australian Army, which was too small to accommodate fighter planes. Instead, it functioned as an emergency landing strip and for lighter aircraft. The Japanese occupied Talisia in 1942 and remained there until early 1944 when US Marines captured it. Two emergency landings were made there within a week's time in September of that year. At first, an American B-25H bomber began experiencing engine trouble shortly after taking off toward another base. Not wanting to risk the flight, the pilot returned to Talisia and brought the plane back down to the ground. Just days later, an engine failed on a Lockheed Ventura after the successful bombing of a Japanese-occupied airstrip in the region. Knowing that the aircraft wouldn't make it all the way back to its base, the pilot landed at Talisia. The military abandoned the site when the war ended, leaving behind the B-25H bomber and the Lockheed Ventura that it emergency landed there. They're still there, where they've become surrounded by the encroaching plant life that's taking over the base. The airstrip has become nearly completely concealed and is tough to spot. A four-wheel drive vehicle is required to visit what's left of the Talisia airfield, which sits along a cutaway path that runs through the forest.
Number 9. Tanks in Antarctica. Admiral Richard Byrd led an Antarctic research expedition team of 59 men. Their ship transported their equipment to Antarctica and included the only two tanks to serve ever on the continent. Developed during the 1930s, one vehicle is an M2A2 light tank. The other is a 1936 T3 light tank. They were too heavy to operate efficiently in the snow, even after crews removed some armor and weaponry. There were ongoing issues with water getting into the fuel tanks and moisture in the engine's air filters froze. Escalating World War II tensions cut the Byrd expedition short. The Army evacuated two bases that they established during the project, and they left the two tanks behind. The rusting vehicles are still there today, where they serve as an inconvenient reminder that almost no corner of the globe remains untouched by human activity. Rescuing these vehicles would prove to be an enormous task. Number 8. Douglas C-47 Skytrain. While flying from Alaska to Montana in 1950, a C-54 Skymaster military plane vanished, seemingly into thin air over Canada's Yukon Territory. There were 44 people aboard, including three civilians, when the aircraft disappeared. Search crews have never found a single sign of the plane or anyone on it, despite extensive efforts to recover it. Search and rescue missions began just an hour after the C-54 went missing, with American and Canadian authorities working together to scour a 350,000 square mile area of the Pacific Northwest. Sadly, the search proved fruitless and led to more destruction. Four of the 85 planes involved in the search ended up crashing, including a Douglas C-47 Skytrain that encountered bad weather while flying near a mountain in Whitehorse. A downdraft hit it, sending it plunging into the mountainside. All 10 crew members survived and rescue teams saved them, but the plane itself remains at the crash site, where it occasionally gets buried in snow. The only potential clues regarding the missing C-54's whereabouts that were ever uncovered were some unintelligible radio signals and an eyewitness report of a large plane flying overhead in British Columbia, 500 miles south of the Yukon border. To this day, nobody knows what happened. Number 7. USS Annapolis. The fast-attack submarine USS Annapolis is the fourth vessel in American history to be named after the United States Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland. It entered service in the early 90s and is based out of San Diego, California. Designed to seek and destroy enemy submarines and ships, the 360-foot-long vessel often travels at speeds of over 28 miles per hour. The military had it built to perform various other tasks, including intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance (ISR) missions, supporting battle group operations, and engaging in mine warfare. The Annapolis is a good example of how the U.S. has achieved a prominent role in undersea battle technology through its focus on speed, endurance, mobility, stealth, and payload. There are three different classes of submarines that operate under the U.S. Navy's submarine force. As a Los Angeles-class vessel, the Annapolis is part of the fleet that serves as the backbone of the force. During a two-week training program in 2009 known as the ICE exercise, the submarine had just emerged from the depths of the Arctic Ocean, breaking through 3 feet of ice to get to the surface. In photos that appeared online, it seemed to many like the Annapolis had perhaps gotten stuck. But manufacturers built it to withstand even the most extreme conditions, and it was just doing one of the many things that they designed it for. Number 6. Arctic Radar Stations. As Cold War tensions intensified during the 1950s, then-US President Dwight D. Eisenhower realized it was important to be aware of any incoming missile or air attacks on North America. He called for the construction of a radar station network high above the Arctic Circle so that it would alert the government if the Soviets targeted the US from the polar region. Known as the Distinct Early Warning or DEW line, the chain of 63 stations took a little more than 2 years to build. It stretched 3,000 miles across the 69th parallel from Alaska to Greenland. Most of the stations were in Canada. The DEW line operated for less than a decade before Soviet intercontinental ballistic missiles, or ICBMs, rendered the radar technology obsolete. Because designers only equipped the stations to detect aircraft and missiles traveling slower than the speed of sound, they were incapable of predicting an ICBM attack. The military decommissioned the stations and gave their 4-to-5-person crews merely an hour to evacuate. Some of the stations that were still in use were the DEW line successor systems. During the mid-90s, there was a massive cleanup of the deserted stations, which had become open dumps full of debris. Only a few of the abandoned stations still exist today. Two of them will soon disappear into the Greenland ice cap, which is thousands of feet thick. The LIS-2 station in Point Lay, Alaska is the only station that was preserved. They left the rest of the derelict properties to rot and are strewn with decaying buildings and rusting equipment. The snow has partially buried many of the structures, which has found its way into the building's interiors. Number 5. Port Lockroy. In the Palmer Archipelago west of Antarctica, an Antarctic expedition discovered the natural harbor of Port Lockroy in 1904 during the French Antarctic Expedition. The explorers named it after the French politician Edouard Lockroy, who helped secure government funding for the project. From 1911 to 1930, fishermen used the harbor for whaling. Then, during World War II, the British embarked on a secret expedition to Antarctica known as Operation Tabarin and established a military base at Port Lockroy. Known simply as Station A, it operated as a research facility on Goodyear Island until 1962. Scientists performed important work there, including the first measurements of the ionosphere and the first audio recording of magnetic waves known as an atmospheric whistler. In 1996, the British Antarctic Survey began renovating the old buildings, which include a museum and the world's most remote post office. Researchers study the site to learn more about the effects of tourism on penguins. It's one of the most popular Antarctic cruise ship destinations, with about 70,000 pieces of mail being processed at the post office during the five-month visiting season every year. And if you've ever dreamed of visiting Antarctica, now might be your chance. Earlier this year, the UK Antarctic Heritage Trust announced that it's looking for people to run the post office, which has been closed since the pandemic. The station usually receives hundreds of applications for the five-month tourist season, but has consistently faced understaffing issues for 2 years now. Ideal candidates are in good health and have some knowledge about living minimally, including without running water since there's none on the island. Would you work at Port Lockroy? Let me know in the comments below, but first, be sure to subscribe. Number 4. P-38 Fighter Planes. As the Nazis encroached on the United Kingdom in 1942, the United States rushed hundreds of warplanes to the British Isles to aid our ally in the war effort. But not all the aircraft reached their destination. In July of that year alone, six Lockheed P-38 fighter jets and two B-17 bombers made emergency landings in Greenland because of harsh weather. Rescue teams saved the crew members, but they left the eight planes behind in an ice field. Over the following decades, they became buried in nearly 300 feet of snow. Members of the Greenland Expedition Society unearthed one plane, nicknamed P-38 Glacier Girl, in 1992 after years of searching and digging. They restored it to flying condition and took it to the skies in 2002 for the first time in 60 years. Shortly after P-38 Glacier Girl returned to the air, a pilot attempted to fly it on the original route across the Atlantic that it had failed to complete decades earlier. Unfortunately, he only made it to Labrador, Canada, where he had to land the aircraft because of a coolant leak. A search team returned to the ice field in Greenland in 2018 and found another P-38 nicknamed Echo. They announced plans to disassemble it and raise it piece by piece. The other four P-38s and the two B-17 bombers remain missing. Number 3. The Penguin. Traversing unforgiving polar terrain became a lot easier with the development of vehicles that were designed specifically for that purpose. But it took some trial and error, and one of the earliest designs proved horrendously flawed. Known as the Antarctic Snow Cruiser and nicknamed the Penguin, manufacturers designed the vehicle as a mobile base for the U.S. Antarctic Survey Expedition. Manufacturing crews built it hastily over 11 weeks in 1939, and it malfunctioned repeatedly from the moment they completed it. During the 1,020-mile trip from Chicago to its departure port in Boston, the Penguin steering system was damaged, causing it to drive off a bridge in Ohio. It was stuck for 3 days before continuing along its journey. The vehicle's next stop was the Bay of Whales in Antarctica, where it immediately experienced problems upon its arrival. Its designers thought it was a good idea to equip the Penguin with tires that had no tread, which they designed for a swamp vehicle. It navigated poorly in the snow and ice, the tires spun freely whenever someone tried to drive them, and attaching chains to them did little to help, because the chains slipped around the treadless tires. Drivers discovered the Penguin operated better in reverse. It traveled backward for all 92 miles of its longest trek. Soon enough, the U.S. became entangled in World War II and the Antarctic expedition was abandoned, along with the Penguin. It was briefly spotted in 1958 below 23 feet of snow. The interior was exactly as it had been left, serving as a time capsule of the moment the crews had left and were called back to America. After that, the vehicle once again disappeared. It hasn't been seen since, leading researchers to believe that the snow and ice have reburied it or it could have fallen into the Southern Ocean. Number 2. Pegasus Wreck. Two pilots faced a tough decision on October 8, 1970 when the U.S. Navy C-21 Lockheed Constellation aircraft they were flying from New Zealand to Antarctica hit bad weather. They were already past the point of safe return and were running short on fuel, so turning around and flying back to New Zealand wasn't an option. The pair ultimately had no option but to fly through the horrendous weather and continue to McMurdo Station. With 80 people on board, it was a dangerous undertaking, but they had no other safe choices. The plane, nicknamed the Pegasus, soon encountered whiteouts and heavy winds that jostled it around so badly that parts broke off in midair. As the pilots circled the runway, they realized it was impossible to get a visual and that they'd have to land blindly. They landed safely outside the base on their second attempt, but the experience was quite unpleasant for everyone aboard. The plane descended rapidly, spun around, and skidded along the ground before finally coming to a stop. By then, its right wing and some of the landing gear had broken off. The emergency landing didn't seriously injure anybody and everyone proceeded with their plans, leaving the aircraft abandoned at the crash site. The Pegasus still sits outside McMurdo today, where it's often partially covered in ice and snow. Number 1. Crashed cargo plane. While traveling from Washington State to Anchorage in 1952, a U.S. Air Force C-124 Globemaster cargo plane crashed into Alaska's Mount Gannett, killing all 52 souls aboard. It landed just miles off course. Air Force officials ruled that a navigational error resulting from poor instruments and bad weather caused the accident. The wreck was barely recognizable when search teams discovered it a week later. Only its tail remained intact, and all 52 passengers aboard had perished. The crash had triggered a major avalanche, encasing the downed aircraft in snow and ice. It became even more hidden over time because of glacial movement. Just a year after the tragedy, the plane had become buried in 50 feet of snow. Nobody saw it again until 2012, when an Army National Guard helicopter pilot spotted debris while flying overhead. At first, officials assumed it was a recent wreck that nobody had reported yet. But a ground search revealed the aircraft's true identity and age. In the 60 years since the crash, the plane had mysteriously traveled 13 miles from the original crash site. Every year, during the 1 month that it's safe to travel to the site, a military volunteer crew goes there and recovers what they can. They've amassed a growing collection of artifacts, including dog tags, uniforms, wedding rings, wallets, and more. The team has also recovered the remains of all but 9 of the people who lost their lives in the wreck, and they hope to find more before the melting glacier sweeps the remaining items into the sea.
9. Moor Hall. In County Mayo, in northwestern Ireland, Moor Hall is the original house and estate of aristocrat George Henry Moore and his family. They played an integral role in Ireland's social, cultural, and political history. Moore built the house in the 1790s, but a fire destroyed it in 1923 during the Irish Civil War. Not long after, the Moors lost much of their influence during the Irish Republican Army's, IRA's, rise to power. The IRA burned the house down because they saw its owner, Maurice Moore, as a supporter of the Anglo-Irish Treaty. The treaty ended the Irish War of Independence in terms the IRA didn't like. Shortly after the IRA destroyed the home, Maurice wrote an account of the event to the local press. What's left of Moor Hall is now owned by the forestry company Qualty, along with the surrounding lake, farm, and estate. While the property attracts visitors, nobody's allowed inside the house, which has undergone no renovation since the IRA burned it down, and so it's in poor condition. The ruins of the home and other buildings are becoming overgrown with trees and other foliage. They're a shell of what they once were, and will eventually become a distant memory. 8. Vindolanda. Near Hadrian's Wall, in a remote section of Northumberland, England, the Roman auxiliary fort Vindolanda is known for having the biggest collection of Roman leather shoes and boots ever found. Dating back nearly 2,000 years, it sat at the edge of the empire, where it guarded the Staingate, a major highway that led to Caledonia. The Romans built and rebuilt the timber and stone forts at Vindolanda at least 9 times throughout the site's occupation. Besides footwear, archaeologists have unearthed over 7,000 other artifacts. They found large numbers of tent panels, decorations, horse gear, leather scraps, and more. While searching hundreds of objects from the site in 1993, researchers found an offcut in the shape of a mouse. It was roughly 4.8 inches by 1 inch, and with slits marking its eyes and fur. They dated it back to sometime between 105 AD and 130 AD. They concluded it was likely a child's toy, or that someone perhaps used it as part of a practical joke of some sort. The most remarkable discoveries at the site are by far the Vindolanda tablets. Found near the floors of buried wooden forts, they're the oldest known surviving handwritten documents in Britain. They provide a rare glimpse into the daily goings-on at Vindolanda nearly 2 millennia ago. They include details of its residents' private and military lives. Several of the tablets, which discuss everyday matters like birthday cards and underwear, are on display at the Roman Vindolanda Fort and Museum at the original site. 7. Poland's Cold War Bunkers. There are several Cold War-era Soviet nuclear bunkers that you'll only find the remnants of if you stray deep enough into Poland's dense forests. Locals seeking scrap metal have stripped most of these sites down to the bare minimum, leaving behind overgrown concrete tunnels and other ruins. We know little about the bunkers because of their top-secret nature. Mostly, their existence is absent from historical documents, leaving their crumbling ruins as the best source for archaeologists and historians to learn from. The Soviets put the installations in place to house nuclear warheads during the late 1960s. It soon became clear to the Soviets that they wouldn't have enough time to transport weapons to Poland and their other satellite states if NATO attacked. Poland's government paid for the bunkers that were built within the country, but the USSR controlled the sites, and the Polish people didn't know they even existed. In 2019, archaeologist Gregor Kiarzys took an in-depth look at the nuclear bunkers. He found evidence of things that are not documented in records, including signs that women and children lived in the areas surrounding the sites. Kiarzys told National Geographic that the illusion of normal life may have been a deliberate ploy to distract locals from suspicion about what was going on in the forest. He found plastic toys in disposal areas and confirmed through old photos that women and children lived at the bases. The Polish people only learned about the bunkers when the Soviet Union left the country in 1991, and USSR records about the sites have since been closed. By treating them as archaeological sites, experts are finally learning bits and pieces of what went on in and around the bunkers. 6. Goli Otok. On the northern Croatian coast in the Adriatic Sea, there's a barren island called Goli Otok that was once home to a political prison that operated when the country was part of Yugoslavia. It contains the remnants of an auditorium, barracks, industrial buildings, and other structures where inmates and staff lived, worked, and gathered. Nicknamed the Croatian Alcatraz, the top-secret high-security facility housed prisoners from 1949 to 1989. Besides functioning as a penitentiary, it was also a labor camp. They only housed men at Goli Otok, but the conditions were similar for female inmates, who the government took to a prison on the nearby island of Sveti Gruga. Until 1956, Goli Otok operated specifically as a camp for political prisoners, including thousands of Stalinists and any other individuals who the government saw as having Soviet sympathies. They were enemies of the Yugoslavian state in the aftermath of the dictator Josip Broz Tito's 1949 split from Joseph Stalin. The conditions were brutal, giving the prison the reputation of Tito's gulag. Guards worked inmates nearly to death as they forced them to quarry tunnels and build the very fortifications that they languished in. They also put them through a so-called re-education regimen that involves severely punishing anyone the staff members even slightly suspected of acting out of line with the dictator's ways. The horror of Goli Otok spread to the mainland, where civilians lived in constant fear of being taken away by the Yugoslavian secret police for the smallest offenses. Those who made it back to the mainland from Goli Otok were even more silent about their fears than the average citizen. They'd already lived to experience the horror, and were terrified of going through it again. If you were caught by the enemy and placed in a work camp, would you try to escape or wait to be rescued? Let us know in the comments, and make sure you subscribe to the channel so you don't miss out on more videos like these. 5. Kaboro Station. Japan has many abandoned or semi-abandoned decaying train stations that see little to no modern use. Many of them are in rural regions that attract limited visitors aside from the handful of the off-the-beaten-path explorers. These visitors are looking to experience something other than typical tourist destinations. The most secluded of these scattered sites is Kaboro Station. On Japan's northernmost main island, Hokkaido, the station is on a 261-foot between two tunnels. There's no road nearby. The only way to get anywhere near the station is by train or boat. There is a beach close to the station, but getting there requires traveling down a steep, overgrown path. Kaboro Station opened in 1943 as a servicing point for trains carrying munitions. Passengers could ride the trains, but the government didn't reclassify the depot as a railroad station until 1987. By then, it had long sat neglected and barely used. The area's heyday had long come and gone. During the 60s, there was a nearby campground and seaside resort, and there was also one settlement on the beach, but people abandoned it during the 70s. Nobody lives near the station today, therefore, almost nobody uses it. The railway company in charge of Kaboro Station considered closing it in recent years. But the nearest community objected to the move and agreed in 2015 to fund the station's maintenance in the future. While its future remains uncertain, recent efforts to promote Kaboro Station as a tourist destination were successful, proving that it can have a promising future if the community continues putting in the work to keep it alive. 4. Sheffield Ski Village. There's a collection of rusting ski lifts, dry overgrown slopes, and other equipment sitting on a hilltop in Sheffield, England. The former ski resort opened in 1988, yet it looks like it's been abandoned since then. But that was just the beginning of what grew to be a sprawling site that by 1994 had 8 slopes, a bar, a lodge, and shops. It continued to expand from there, adding laser tag, four-wheelers, and a bowling alley. The resort thrived well into the 2000s and even became the official training ground for half the British freestyle Olympic skiing team. But things went suspiciously wrong in April 2012 when a fire destroyed the main building. Officials ruled the fire accidentally started. Soon after, arsonists partially destroyed the huts at the top of the main slope and the bunny slope. After these first few attacks, Sheffield Ski Village closed its doors to the public. Oddly, arsonists continued to target the site in a series of repeated fires. To this day, they remain at large, and nobody knows what their motive was for the attacks. The resort has been left to decay, as it falls victim to illegal garbage dumping and graffiti artists. Sheffield City Council hasn't given up on the site, and in 2016 began trying to recruit investors to bring it back to life. The original constructor, who agreed to redevelop Sheffield Village into an extreme sports facility, went back on the deal last year. Now, the council is reportedly engaged in talks with another company about the possibility of redeveloping the site. But for now, the ruins of Sheffield Village continue to become an even bigger eyesore with time. 3. Cave of the Jaguar God. While working on the Yucatan Peninsula in 2018, archaeologists from Mexico's National Institute, INAH, accidentally discovered a sealed cave full of treasure amid a sprawling maze of dark underground tunnels. They found the hoard in a series of 7 sacred subterranean chambers known as Balamku, or Jaguar God. They sit beneath the ruins of Chichen Itza, an ancient Maya city that thrived between the 9th and 13th centuries AD, during which its population peaked in the millions. Within the cave, the team uncovered over 150 artifacts, including vases, incense burners, and decorative plates featuring the faces of gods and religious icons. Scholars believe the site was left mostly untouched for over 1,000 years. Archaeologist Victor Segovia Pinto discovered the cave in 1966, but he didn't fully investigate or excavate it. He hired local farmers to seal the cave's entrance for reasons that remain a mystery to this day. Even more strangely, Pinto's archaeological records conveniently went missing after that. Until recent decades, archaeologists were primarily interested in monument archaeology rather than cave archaeology, according to National Geographic. Although the significance of such sites has long gone unrecognized, modern researchers are lucky to examine the recently discovered objects in their undisturbed state. Through these artifacts, they hope to learn more about the mysterious Mayan collapse. Some scholars believe the collapse was triggered by a series of catastrophic droughts and other unfortunate events. 2. Laurel Valley Sugar Plantation. During the 1830s, the first structures of what would eventually become a sprawling sugar plantation sprang up in Thibaudieu, Louisiana, on a 50,000-acre plot of land owned by a man named Jacob Tucker. Known as the Laurel Valley Sugar Plantation, its operations relied on forced labor as it expanded and passed from one generation of the Tucker family to the next. At its peak, over 170 slaves lived and worked at the plantation. They slept in tiny, overcrowded, primitive structures that had no screens on the windows to keep mosquitoes out. The owners forced the slaves to work in the brutal heat and were under the constant threat of malaria. Sadly, there were stories of mothers who couldn't bear the thought of bringing a child into that brutal existence. These mothers felt they had no other choice but to commit infanticide. Some women killed their babies to spare them from the constant suffering and misery that they had endured. The Tuckers were fiercely loyal to the Confederacy, since losing their slaves would bankrupt them. They ended up selling the plantation when the Union won the war. This, unfortunately, didn't end the brutal living conditions that the end of the war had technically freed the slaves from. Racial discrimination continued to run rampant, and wages were incredibly low, leaving many with few other choices than to continue working at the plantation for meager pay. These conditions did little to improve their quality of life. 50 of the original structures still stand today, along with some of the machinery that was used to harvest and process the cane sugar plants. They remain as a testament to a painful but important chapter in American history that deserves to be told. 1. Tynham Village. Known as Dorset's Lost Village, the former civil parish of Tynham is near the shoreline in southern England's sparsely populated countryside. It's in a secluded valley where the earliest evidence of human occupation dates back to the Roman era. Archaeologists have also found Iron Age artifacts. People inhabited the area until 1943, when the War Office of the British government evacuated 225 residents so the military could use the land as a training ground and firing range. Displaced residents left cooperatively, with the understanding that the government would eventually allow them to come back. The authorities went back on their word. After World War II ended, the military remained at Tynham, and it continued to use the land as a training ground to this day. What's left of the village is a ghost town. It's been open to visitors since 1975. Many of its original buildings still stand, including the 13th century Church of St. Mary, some homes, and a schoolhouse. Others have been demolished or destroyed. The forced relocation of Tynham's residents is unfair and heartbreaking. But the diminished human presence in the region had one beneficial effect. It's become a haven for wildlife, and a de facto nature refuge, despite the military scrap that litters the area. Which of these abandoned places would you like to visit? Let us know in the comments below, and while you're at it, be sure to subscribe to the channel. See you soon. Bye!